and he could see that it was the end of Dwapar Yug, and the Kurukshetra Yudh Bhumi was very close. And he realized one thing, that the people of Kali Yuga are going to be short-sighted, deprived of long and healthy Ayu, and there will be a lot of confusions, and people will live for their swartha, for their own definitions of lifestyle, not caring for what is to be done. So, out of compassion, he divided the Vedas into four, the Rig, the Sam, the Yajur, and the Atharva. And each he gave it to one Rishi Muni, and those Rishi Munis, they did the Sankalan of that. Then came the Mahabharata. And when it came the Mahabharata, he meditated on Lord Brahma, because this was the longest written history text, 108,000 verses. And he had in his mind that it is better somebody else writes it, because he just wanted to ensure that everything is done meticulously and without any mistakes. So at that point of time, Lord Brahma invited Lord Ganesha, the son of Mahadev, Shiv, and Mother Parvati, and requested him that, would you please write down this kavya or this poem for our Srila Vyasadeva. So Brahma was present, and this place is called Sri Badrika Ashram. They have the Nar Narayan Rishi Hills, and Lord Ganesha came, and he did his obeisances to Vyasa. Vyasa being the incarnation of Krishna, he is the 15th incarnation of Vishnu, and he also bowed to Ganesha, and they both had some goodies with each other. And then the protocol was set in front of Brahma as the witness. And the protocol was that whatever Vyasa will say, Ganesha will write. But Ganesha said that if there is a mistake, then I also know the truth. I will stop listening to Vyasa and I will write the truth. So Vyasa, he said, I agree to your point. But Vyasa told him that whatever I say, you also have to understand and write. Simply you are not going to write. So whatever I say, you understand. And Ganesha says, whatever you say, I will understand and write. And should there be even one mistake in that, then I will stop listening to you and I will complete the Grantha by myself. So this thing happened, but nothing of that sort happened. Vyasa spoke, Ganesha understood, Ganesha wrote, but there was nothing that Ganesha could object on, and there was nothing that Vyasa could complain about. And that is how the beautiful book Mahabharata came out. And the final Granth of Srimad Bhagavatam was also done in the same way. So we have to understand that when we talk about the Mahajanas, so let me start by reading the verse. Just before that, I gave you an introduction, and before proceeding into the subject matter, I seek blessings from each one of you, because each one of you are glorious to be having seated with us and spending your time and trying to understand the beautiful Srimad Bhagavatam and the beautiful Lord Shiva with his wonderful wife Srimati Durga Devi. Om Namo Bhagavate Vasudevaya. Om Namo Bhagavate Vasudevaya. Om Namo Bhagavate Vasudevaya. Narayanam Namaskritya Naram Chaiva Narottamam Devim Sarasvatim Vyasam Tato Jayam Udhirya Et Shanuvatam Swakathara Krishna Punya Shravana Kirtanam Hridayantastaya Bhadrani Vidunoti Surutsatam Nashta Prayesho Bhadreshu Nityam Bhagavata Sevaya Bhagavate Uttama Shloke Bhaktir Bhavati Naishtiki Mukham Karati Vachalam Pangum Langete Giram Jatki Patramam Mandu Shri Guru Dinatarima Paramananda Madhava Om Ajnana Timurandasya Jnananjana Shalakaya Chakshurum Militamima Tasmai Shri Guru Vinama Shri Chaitanya Manobhishtam Snapitam Yama Bhutale Swayam Rupa Paramananda Bhakti Swapadantikam Vandeham Shri Guru Shri Utapata Kamalam Shri Guru Vashtalam Shri Rupam Sattva Sajana Raghunatham Vitantam Sajivam Sadvaitam Savadikam Bhagyana Sattva Krishna Chaitanya Devam Shri Radha Krishna Bhagavan Sajana Lalitam Shri Vishakam Vitam Shri Krishna Karuna Sindhu Dina Bhagya Jalakya Gopesha Gopika Kanta Radha Kanta Namasiri Tattva Kanchana Gauran Virate Vindhavan Kachu Vrishabhanu Sute Devi Pranamami Hari Priya Vanchakal Patarurus Chakripa Sindhu Devam Chupatitanam Bhagavan वैष्णवेभ्यो नमो नमः जय श्री कृष्ण चैतन्य प्रभु नित्यानंद श्री अद्वैत गदाधर शिवासादि गौर भक्तवृंद हरे कृष्ण 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 हरे 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 राम वेलकम एवरीबॉडी। सो So since we are discussing on the subject matter of 12 Mahajanas, let me just read this verse. It says that Swayambhur Narada Shambhu Kumarah Kapilo Manuhu Pralada Janako Bhishmo Balir Vayashakir Vaya. So this is from Srimad Bhagavatam, 6th canto, chapter number 3, verse number 20. It says that the 12 Mahajanas, Brahma, Narad, Shiva, Kumara, Kapila, Manu, Prahlad, Janak, Bhishma, Bali, Shukadev Goswami and Yamaraj are the agents of the Lord authorized to speak and propagate the principle of religion. So these are the agents of the Lord. They have been chosen by the Lord to speak about himself by them. So we need to understand that these 12 personalities are very dear to the Lord. That is the reason they are called Mahajanas, and at the same time, they worship the Supreme Lord Narayana or Krishna with all their hearts. And so what happens then? So once they are dedicated that they should do this, the next verse it says from the Padma Purana, it says, Shri Brahma Rudra Sanaka Vaishnava Shiti Pavanaha Chatavarse Chakalo Bhavya Hya Utkale Purushottama. So what he says, Shri, Brahma, Rudra, Sanaka. So these are the names of the four sampradayas. Shri is for Shri Sampradaya. And you see the Iyengar Brahmins of the South India, they follow the Shri Sampradaya. They are the followers of Shri Ramanujacharya. So that is Shri. Brahma. Brahma Sampradaya is coming and it is associated to Shri Madhvacharya of Udupi Sri Krishna Peeth. So you know Shri Madhvacharya was very famous and he gave the Vishishta Dvaita philosophy. Third is Rudra. Rudra means Lord Shiva. So he has his own sampradaya of preaching the glories of Lord Narayana. And he becomes the master of Vishnu Swami. And you call them also as Vallabhacharya or Shri Pushtimargi. The temple of Nathdwara is where you can see the Vallabhacharya devotees, followers coming there. And the fourth is Shanaka, where the four Sanat Kumaras, and they are from Nimbarka Swami. This you find in the central Madhya Pradesh and also UP Bihar. But this is on an extent. The three major sampradayas right now which are in existence are Shri by Ramanuja, Brahma by Madhva, and Rudra by Nimbarkas by Vishnu Swami or Shri Vallabhacharya, those who come from the Pushti Margi background. And all four, they will appear in the holy place of Jagannath Puri to purify the entire world during the Kali Yuga. So all these four personalities, if you see, Ramanuja, he actually established the Matha in Jagannath Puri. Vallabhacharya, he went to Jagannath Puri. Lord Rudra, he has been to Jagannath Puri. It's because they all understand that in the Kali Yuga, people will be so much distorted. People will be so much deviated. People will be so much disturbed. People will be so much confused that they require an authentic parampara system by which we can train them and give them an idea as to how they go back home, back to Godhead. Now, you see Lord Shiva is in the status of Mahajana. As I told you, he is very dear to Krishna. He is there in the Sampradaya system. And let me see what else is there. Now it says, the Srimad Bhagavatam also says, 12th canto, chapter number 13, verse number 16, it says that Nimnaganam yatha ganga devanam achyuto yatha vaishnavanam yatha shambho puranamitam tatha. Now it is giving the glorification of the most important personalities in the face of the earth. And here also Lord Shiva finds a place over here. See, he is everywhere. It says, just as the Ganga is the greatest of all rivers, Lord Achyuta, the supreme among the gods, Lord Shambhu, the greatest of the Vaishnavas, and Srimad Bhagavatam is the greatest of all the Puranas. So many a times the people, they say, you people coming from Krishna conscious, you Vaishnavas will always only support Vaishnava scripture. What about the Shiva scripture? What about the Brahma scripture? Because there are 18 Purans and you are all gaga about only Bhagavatam, Bhagavatam, Bhagavatam. See, we all have our own attachments to our personalities because that is our conditioning of the soul by the past Janma. So there is nothing wrong in that, because one thing what I appreciate is that every one of us is pious, every one of us is religious, and everyone has a faith, and the faith determines by the level of understanding we have. So there is no dispute among that whom you are following or whom you are loving. We always have choices in life, but that necessarily does not mean that whom you like is the ultimate. He may be the best for you, but there could be someone better. So this is the same thing which Vyasa did. Vyasa started compiling the Puranas. So when he started compiling the Puranas, he compiled the Puranas personality based. Shiva Puran, Agni Puran, Vayu Puran, Brahma Vaivarta Puran, Garuda Puran, Narada Puran. Yeah? So like that there are 18 Puranas, Vishnu Puran. So each Purana is glorifying the personality on whom it is written. So if you say Shiva Puran, it says Shiva is the Supreme. If you take Vishnu Puran, it says Vishnu is the Supreme. You take Brahma Puran, it says Brahma is the Supreme. So in this way, when all the 17 Puranas were compiled, 4 Vedas were compiled, 108 Upanishads were compiled, the Mahabharata was about to be written. It was not yet written at that point of time, because the Kurukshetra war was just ending. So Vyasa was very despondent. He said, after all these great achievements, why am I not feeling that satisfaction? Because then he became despondent and he started remembering his Guru Narada. He said, my dear Lord, O Guru Maharaj, please appear in front of me. You see this wonderful work that I have done, but I am not satisfied with all such a huge writing. And it's not easy to write so many things. In all, when you are compiling, if you remove the Bhagavatam 18,000 verses, already 540,000 verses were written at that point of time. That includes the Vedas and the Puranas. 540,000 plus 18,000, 558,000 verses. Imagine, it's not easy. We cannot compile a simple poem. After studying, we cannot make our own notes. We start wondering what to write. But here was a person who was an amsha of Lord Krishna, who was an empowered soul. He was able to write, but he was not happy. And Narada said, very smilingly said, my dear sir, he was sarcastic. So you have done what you are supposed to do, but you didn't do what you were supposed to do. So you have done what you wanted to do, I'm sorry, but you didn't do what you're supposed to do. So what was I supposed to do? I did this, I did that, I wrote this, I wrote that. He said, you wrote the personalities, great. But did you write about the personality who created these personalities? And Vyasa was shocked. He said, oh, no, but I did mention about him in each Puranas. I did mention about him in Vishnu Purana. I did mention about him in Shiva Purana. I did mention about him in Brahma Purana, Vayu Purana, but I have given. He said, Baba, that is intermittent, but you have not glorified him to the exception. You have not given the relation of him and his devotee. And this is the reason you are not happy. So when Narada enlightened him with what he was supposed to do, then Vyasa closed his eyes. Before closing his eyes, he took the blessings of his guru. He checked with him. He said, what should I do? And Narada, when he glorified him, this you can read in the first canto, chapter number 5, Narada's instruction to Vyasa. It's a beautiful literature about the guru-shishya relationship. If one wants to progress in Krishna consciousness, one should understand that one should, how should you approach a guru and how you should respect him and how you should take his blessings. Beautifully done. And then after that, Vyasa goes into a trance. And when he goes into the trance, by the mercy of his guru, he is able to understand the Supreme Personality, Ete Chamsha Kalapumsa, Krishna's Tu Bhagavan Swayam, Indrari Vyakulam Lokam Radayanti Yudhi. So then he could realize that, oh, I wrote a personality based booklets, but now I have to write the Samam Bonam, Samam Bonam means from the absolute truth. There are many gods, but there is only one absolute. And that absolute is Bhagavan's revelation. And that is the reason the second verse, what it says? It says that Dharma Projita Kaitavo Atra Nirmatsara Nam Satam Vedyam Vastavam Atra Vastu Shivadam Tapatrayam Moolanam Srimad Bhagavate Mahamuni Krite Kimvapare Ishwara. See the statement what he writes. Srimad Bhagavate Mahamuni Krite. This Srimad Bhagavatam is presented by Mahamuni. Mahamuni means he became matured, paripakva. Wo matured ho gaye. Tab tak he was just writing based on Muni means it can change. Two Munis will not have the same philosophy. One will say East is good, one will say West is good. But a Mahamuni, he becomes completely matured with enlightenment of understanding that this is the truth. So he said, Kimma Pare Ishwara, what is the need of going to any other personalities? So you see, this is how the Bhagavatam came into existence. So sometimes when people do question that why Bhagavatam, well, we have to understand that Bhagavatam is the final decree. Before that, all the decrees were there, so many amendments were there, so many adjustments were there, but they were all nullified by Srimad Bhagavatam. And in Srimad Bhagavatam, you can see Lord Shiva is glorified as a Param Vaishnava. Of all the Vaishnavas, Madhvacharya, Ramanujacharya, of all, even Mother Lakshmi, she is also a Vaishnavi because she is the devotee of Lord Narayana. But Shiva is superior to her also. Shiva is superior to her also. And Shiva is a very, very powerful personality. So, this personality, he is also called as the Jagat Pita. This particular material world, he is the father of this material world. He is the person who, along with Durga or Parvati, is running the show over here. That is the reason you are having 51 Shakti Pitas and 12 Jyotirlingas. So, and Narayana temples are very less, unless you go to state-wise, like you may have Tirupati in Andhra, you may have Ranganatha Swami in Tamil Nadu, you may have Padmanabha in Kerala, then you can have Udupi Sri Krishna in Karnataka, then you can have Jagannath Ji in Puri, then you can have Lord Panduranga in Pandharpur, then you have Dwarkadish in Gujarat. So like that, Rajasthan is Nathdwara, so Radha Govind, then Mathura, Vrindavan. So you see, until Badrinath, you are having the personality. So each personality is there. But still, if you go to see, in this material world, many people are either Shiva Bhakta or Devi Bhaktas. Because they being the owner, they have more precedence over Narayana over here. So, and also when you read the Puranas like Shiva Puran or Bhagavati, Devi Puran, you feel that, okay, they are the Supreme. Well, let me ascertain you one point. They are Supreme. They are Supreme in one sense because they are the owners of this material world. And the supremacy has been awarded to them. It's just like for a layman like me who's a small villager, for me, the sarpanch of the panchayat is the supreme. Because I need not go out and meet anybody. So from that perspective, my respect towards him is there. My agreement that he is the supreme is right. And whatever is my requirement is taken care by him. And that finishes over there. But the moment this layman leaves that particular village or district and goes to the district level, and there he goes and sees that there are so many villages and each one has got a sarpanch. Because here the district collector becomes the head of the department. And then what happens? You go out of the district to the major city and you say that all these districts are run by chief minister. And when you move out of the state to the national level, you see that this is run by the prime minister. So on each level, till the time you do not know that there is a superior level, you are confined and content in thinking that this is the Supreme. So, and there are many scenarios where you see that they will be able to exercise their power of supremacy. So by that we start feeling that this is it. But we should always understand that if you go and tell Lord Shiva that you are the Supreme, he'll start smiling at you and say, what are you? I am Supreme for you, but I know who is Supreme. Because that is the reason I have been nominated as one of the Mahajanas to speak about. Just to clear your doubts, I have been taking the position of a Mahajana. Just to make you understand, I have become a Sampradaya Acharya. And just for our understanding that who is the Param Vaishnava, Srila Vyasa has mentioned Vaishnavanam Yatha Shambho. So this becomes the background for our understanding what is the glories of Lord Shiva, a personality who takes care of Lord Narayana's requirement. So let's see. Let's see now that what is the activities of Lord Shiva. Before I start, would anybody like to tell me what is the activity you know about Lord Shiva?
Hare Krishna, Prabhu.
Prabhuji,
when you're asking about activities, are you asking about what are,
His leelas. His leelas, yeah. Lord Shiva's leela. One or two can just tell what are the interesting leelas of Lord Shiva.
He's swallowed poison, so he's called Neelakanta.
Fantastic. Fantastic. Yes, he is Neelakanta because when the halahal wish came out, he put it in his neck and ensured that everything is taken care of. Yeah? What next?
He is Gangadhari.
Yes, he is Gangadhar. He has taken Mother Ganga on his head. And it is because of him that we, Prithvivasis, are able to have the association of Mother Ganga, because Mother Ganga is also his wife. How many of you know that Ganga is his wife?
Not in human understanding terms. His wife means another Shakti, not literal human wife. I mean, the understanding of wife in terms of spirituality is different from what we perceive.
Yeah. That's
because I feel like we feel whatever we like, wife, children, we look even God like that. Because in
I will just enhance your knowledge on this, that yes, she is a second wife, because she desired Lord Shiva as her husband, but it was not to happen because her younger sister Parvati got married to her. But eventually Lord Shiva, being a great Vaishnava and the Bhagwan, he realized the requirement. So how did he fulfill the desire of she becoming his wife? Can anyone tell me? In which way did Mother Ganga play a role of his wife?
Then my understanding could be wrong. I mean, Ganga was married to Shantanu.
Well, that was the Amsha of Ganga. She was not. See, I will tell you one thing. The devis and the devatas, they can take multiple forms. Like Amsha of, Indra was Arjun. Amsha of Dharma was Yudhishthir. And also, yeah. Vidur was also Dharmaraj. So you see, they could take. So the Ganga who got married to Shantanu is just a partial expansion. But here I am telling about total Ganga, the absolute personality. How did she play the role in Shiva Leela by being his fantastic wife? She gave a wonderful son. Now I am giving you a clue. She gave a wonderful son. Anybody from South India here? Tamilians?
Kartikeyan.
Yes. Kartikeya is the son of Ganga. How many of you know that? Okay, so I will give you a story from Ramayana now. This is the discussion between Vishwamitra and Lord Ramachandra, because you should understand the glories of Lord Shiva. Okay, and today he being a Mahajana, we will glorify him today. So, after killing the Rakshasa in the Dandakaranya, they were proceeding towards Mithila for attending Sita Swayamvara. So at that point of time, Vishwamitra, when they sat in the Ganges, so he asked, Vishwamitra told Rama that how Ganga came down to the earth. So after Ganga came down to the earth, the idea was that if Ganga falls with the same force as she is traveling from the Swargaloka, the entire earth will be shattered into pieces, because that's the power of Ganga. So at that time, the Ikshvaku Vanshi, Raghu Vanshi king, he meditated on Lord Shiva and convinced him. He said, my dear Lord Shiva, could you please become Gangadhar? And Lord Shiva happily said, because he is also called Ashutosh. One of the name of Lord Shiva is Ashutosh, one who becomes happy very quickly. So he accepted Ganga in his jata. And that is how in the Vedic religion, if a man embraces a woman, of course today there is no point in discussing that, because every friends they embrace each other. But in the actual Vedic Sanatana, only a person, a husband and a wife, can embrace each other. In the, there is a way of embracing, even a father and a daughter embraces, but we understand the difference between the embrace of a husband and wife and embrace of. So actually the embrace, what she went into the jata of Shiva, was actually given the status of a wife to her. And then later on, what happened just before that, just before Ganga could come to the earth, when Shiva and Parvati were married and they got into a conjugal relationship, and the conjugal relationship went for almost 1,000 yugas, thousands of years, and each one of them did not give up, each one was performing the best of the act, because they are the Adi Shakti. And eventually all the devatas, including Brahma, they came and requested Lord Shiva that you have to stop this process, because out of this the child which will come will dislocate the Bhumandal from the orbit, and this is not good for you, because you are a tapasvi, and for a tapasvi it does not show goodness to involve in such kind of activity. So Lord Shiva immediately stopped that activity. He said it's okay. But then by that time he had not discharged his semen. The semen was still, it was discharged from the heart, but it did not go down. So what did Lord Shiva do? He just got up, he just meditated on the Supreme Lord, and then he discharged his semen across the face of the Bhumandala, which became the gold and the silver ores. The gold and the silver ores that you get, because it is called Hiranyamai Garbha. Hiranyamai means one which is golden in color. And some part of it, he called Agnidev, and he told Agnidev that keep it with you, because Lord Shiva, understanding that he is a Trikaldarshi, he knows past, present, future very nicely. He is also called Mahakaleshwar. He is the master of time. He is the master of time. That is the reason he is called Mahakaleshwar. So he said, you keep it with you, because he knew that in future there will be some Rakshasa who is going to take the advantage of that Lord Shiva and Parvati are not associating. So this Rakshasa by the name of Tarakasur, he started meditating on Brahma. And he told Brahma that I should be killed only by Shiva Amsha, or the child which is born out of the semen of Lord Shiva. Because Tarakasur thought, now that Lord Shiva is not going to associate with Parvati, and Ganesh is also the Amsha of Mother Parvati, I have nothing to worry and nobody will kill me. And that is the time, that is the time Lord Shiva ordered Agnidev and Ganga. He called Agni and he said, deposit my semen into Ganga Devi. And the moment the semen of Lord Shiva was deposited into Ganga Devi, the entire Ganga started to boil, because the temperature was high. Because other than Parvati, nobody can sustain the temperature of Lord Shiva. And immediately, the child was born, and that is Kartikeya. So, Kartikeya's one name is called Skandaha. Can anyone tell me the meaning of the word Skandaha?
Fast.
In Sanskrit, the meaning of the skanda means
fast.
In Sanskrit, the meaning of the word skanda means one who has flown away from the womb of the mother. वो जो माँ के गर्भ से बह गया उसको कहते हैं स्कंदहा. And this is what happened, because Ganga could not sustain the temperature, so immediately it went in and it came out. And the moment it came out, the child was floating in Ganga. But to protect from Tarakasur, Kritika Nakshatra came down. Because Kritika Nakshatra, there are six damsels working in Kritika Nakshatra. They are the owner. And when they picked up the child was so beautiful. The child was so beautiful that the breast started to milk. The six Nakshatrani's breast, they started to milk. And then Skanda made six heads and he became Aramukham or Shanmugham, so that he could suckle the breast of each Nakshatrani. And that is the reason he became, from Kritika he became Kartikeya. So this story is given in Ramayana, what I am telling you. So Ganga was able to deliver a child in the form of a wife, and she was happy that she was also able to contribute to the, and Skanda went on to become the chief Senapati general of this Devatas. And then when you read the opulence of Krishna in Bhagavad Gita, what does he say? Of Senapati, aham Skandaha. What does Krishna say? Of the Senapati, I am Skanda. And of the Rudra, I am Shankara. And of the Aditya, I am Vishnu. So Krishna is telling, I am only Vishnu, I am only Prajapati, I am only Skanda, I am only Shiva. So then these points were written. Now I have to tell you one thing, that Mahabharata was written by Ganesha. So when Krishna said, I am Shankara Chasmi Rudraho, then he should have raised an objection. Hello, sorry, I have my doubts. How can you give the statement? He didn't raise the statement. When he said that of the Senapati General, I am Skanda, Ganesh did not raise a statement. Again, when he said that of the Prajapatis, I am Prajapati Daksha, he did not raise any statement. And then again what he said, of the Adityas, I am Achyuta or Vishnu. Again, there was no question raised. So this goes to show, because Ganesha is the god of learning, he is the god of intelligence, and we all pray to him to get the best of the intelligence. And when he certified that what is mentioned in Mahabharata and Gita is right, and again in Mahabharata, what comes next? The Vishnu Sahasranam given by Shri Bhishma Pitama. So what was the question asked by Yudhishthir Maharaj? Then he went after being coronated as the king, he said, Kim japan muchyate jantur janma samsara bandhanat. Kim japan muchyate jantur janma samsara. Oh my dear Bhishma Pitama, what is it that we should chant so that we don't take birth again? And what did Bhishma say? Idam anuntam purushottamam. This Keshava Purushottam standing here. Now if you chant his name, you will not take the birth again. And that was also authenticated by Shri Ganesha. I said, yes, that's right. That is right. Because we should understand that each Mahajana has a role to play in Lord Shiva. So Lord Shiva's wonderful pastimes, we know that he drank the halahal. So let me tell you about the halahal story some more, since you all got it.
Prabhuji, once again.
Yeah.
Like after Vishnu Sahasranamam, everything is done. Yudhishthira is asking, in Anushana Parva it is coming, Anushana Parva of Mahabharata, can you tell something about Shiva too?
Yeah, of course.
And, Bhishma is saying, I cannot talk about him, or I don't have the ability to talk about him. So you ask directly Lord Krishna. Then Krishna is saying, Shiva Sahasranama to Yudhishthira.
So, and then what is the outcome of that?
Outcome is, even that is written by Ganapati, so even that is validated.
Yeah, that is right. Because if Krishna says something, Ganapati will write. If Krishna tells something, Ganapati will not object to it. Why can you tell
me? Why do we need to talk about who is supreme? Whoever is supreme, why do we need to bother? What we want is moksha, right?
As I told you, from our perspective, it doesn't matter. But as you grow up, you will have to know that who is the supreme, because there has to be only one supreme. There cannot be two supreme, Mataji. So rather than we discussing about it, that who's the supreme, let us understand that why Lord Shiva has taken the position of a Mahajana and why is he telling to Aradhanam Sarveshu Vishnu. So this is the point what I'm trying to make, that we by our conditioning of the previous Janma are attracted to one personality. But then again, this Lord Shiva is the same personality who is giving you an inspiration to understand who's the supreme. So you should ask this question to Lord Shiva, that how is it that now that I've been worshipping you all these years, you are putting me in a dilemma? Because I too was a Shiva Bhakta for many years. But that same Lord Shiva, he saw that, okay, now that you have come to a level where you can understand the higher levels of studies, let me push you through. And he pushed me through to this system. So I have been indebted to Lord Shiva that he has done what he is supposed to do. I never questioned him that when I say you are the supreme, why are you pushing me to someone else? Because eventually, every Mahajana, every Devata, it will be, they know that who is the supreme. End of the day, what we should understand is that we should accept the words of Mahajana. When Lord Shiva says, like, what does he say? Let me see. It says, there are so many things that we can discuss today, because that is the reason we have to take it in the right perspective. As I told you in the first itself, that we should always take this in. So it says, Aradhanam Sarvesham Vishnu Aradhanam Param Tasmat Parataram Devi Tadiyaniyam Samarchinam. Of all type of worship, worship of Lord Vishnu is best, but better than worshipping Lord Vishnu is the worship of his devotee Vaishnava. So do you get the answer now that why Shiva Sahasranam was told? So Krishna wants you to first worship his devotee, then only he will be available. So that is the reason to counter the situation, because you cannot approach the God directly. So you have to come through a system of a devotee system. So Lord Krishna directly he said, let Shiva Sahasranam also come. So the idea is, what is, because Shiva himself is telling that, it says that one who worships the devotee of the Lord is dear to you. There was once Narada came and asked him, he said, who is dear to you? He said, I am dear to you. Narada said, yes, you are very dear to me. How can I achieve you? He said, go and worship my devotee, then you will know who I am. Because it is the Mahajana who knows. So from this perspective, the Shiva Sahasranam was said. From this perspective, Shiva was made the in charge of the material world. From this perspective, Shiva was given all the power so that he can run the show. But at the same time, Lord Shiva understanding this, he said, okay, enough of my glorification. Now let me take you to my personality, Supreme Personality, whom I am a devotee of. Yeah? Because when Lord Shiva says he is the Supreme, then Krishna has to agree to that point. And then this is how it is between the father and the son. Sometimes the father spouse.
Yeah. Hare Krishna Prabhu. Actually, in that perspective also, that means like during this Kali Yuga also, Raghavendra, Lord Raghavendra, Sai Baba, all of them also had been devotees of Krishna and Rama. And they were continuously chanting Krishna and Rama. And they also have a huge number of devotees who are like devoted completely to Raghavendra or to Sai Baba. And Shiradi is the very, very popular amongst the whole India, right? Sai Baba. So they also guide the same channel through them then to the Lord, right?
Absolutely. The point over here is that you become the devotee of a devotee, then Krishna will accept you. You cannot go directly to Krishna, because Krishna directly says that I cannot be approached directly. You have to come through the channels what I've appointed. So for appointment of the channel, there has to be some kind of faith. That is the reason in Bhagavad Gita, Krishna says that for a soul, when he is desirous of worshipping a devotee, a demigod, I give him that astha, or I give him that faith by which he can worship that personality. But eventually when the time comes to give something, that particular personality goes to Krishna and he says, my dear Lord, what do I do now? The time has come to give the fruit. Should I give? Krishna says, well, give it, because he has worked for it. He deserves it. But at that point of time, what does this Devata or this Mahadevi does? He looks at you and he says, okay, this gentleman seems to be having some additional understanding. I can slowly push him to the Krishna worship. And slowly out of the many devotees who come to the Shiva temple, a few are transferred to the Narayana worship. Because the Padma Puran says, after 7 janma of Shiva worship, one becomes a Surya Narayana worshipper. And after 7 janmas of Surya Narayana worship, one becomes a worshipper of Narayana or the Krishna. So there is a step. You cannot go and tell a third standard child to do derivatives and integration. It's not possible. Because the child does not understand. If you go and tell a second standard child that A plus B is equal to C, he'll say, Appa, why you are making joke of me? How can A and B be added, Appa? So then you say, yes, yes, Kanna, you're right. 1 + 1 = 2. But when the same child, he goes to 8th standard, and when the trigonometry starts, and when he sees that A plus B is equal to C square, so the child was not wrong when he was small, because that was his understanding capacity. So the devotees, the demigods, the Mahadev, the Devi, they also see that, are you getting qualified? Are you in that level to understand who's the Supreme? So till that time, Maya by her illusion keeps you thinking that he's the Supreme. But when you show the interest, when you show the ability that, yes, I am ready for something more. And then they say, okay, this soul is numb. So that is how the soul is transmigrated. So there is a step-by-step thing. The beauty of the Vedic Sanatan Dharma is that you start worshipping the plant, you start worshipping the tree, you worship the light, you worship the air, you worship the water. And eventually, slowly, 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 you come to a level. And where do you come? Then you come to the Mahajana level. And when you come to the Mahajana level, from there you go up. How many of you as Sai Baba devotees agree that Vishnu Sahasranam has to be sung every day?
Yes, Prabhuji. Yes, Prabhuji. Yes, Prabhu. I still am a devotee of Shirdi Sai Baba. When I used to be in India, I used to travel to Shirdi every year as much as I could. And that's where in Shirdi, in one of the in the temple, when apparently it was just through one of those pandits out there. So they were just standing, and I overheard them. He was explaining it to someone else that that one should recite Vishnu Sahasranam every day to attain the final to reach the final destination.
Yeah, so that's the point I'm telling, but how many of them actually know this? So the point what I'm trying to tell you, that Lord Shiva is also an appointed authority, and Shiva actually knows that when you will become matured, he will push you to Vishnu. But till the time you are still addicted to him or still dedicated to him, he will keep you for some time, but slowly he will give an understanding. So most of you who are the Shiva Bhaktas over here are very much in the same shoes as I was 20 years back. So I don't see a reason that sometimes when you do feel that, you know, that enjoyment that, yes, I'm a Shiva Bhakta, because I can tell you, on every Shivratri night, the whole night we used to be in the Shiva temple over here preparing the condensed milk and the sweet milk for the Lord, like grinding the coconut in that. We used to start at 10 in the night and work up to 7 in the morning. And you see what Lord Shiva did to me. He said, okay, bacha, both ho gaya tumhara time, ab aage badho, tumhara promotion ho gaya, niklo idhar se. But even today, because he is a Vaishnava and Yatha Shambho, I proudly go and put my obeisances to the Lord and say, thank you very much, my dear Lord. You made me understand who's the Supreme. The point is not, why should I know who's the Supreme? The point is, if Shiva wants you to know who's the Supreme, then you should agree. Otherwise, you are actually insulting Shiva. When he is wanting you to know, why are you telling no? That's the point.
Yeah, one more thing, Prabhuji. Like in Brahma Vaivarta Purana, Krishna is talking about one of the Narak called Kala Sutra. I think in Narak also there are so many divisions.
Yeah.
So he is saying one who differentiates between Shiva and Krishna, between us, I mean they both are friends, right? Yeah, they go to Kala Sutra Narak. Is it not dangerous to talk about who is supreme? Because Krishna himself is saying that we should not talk about.
In which perspective you are telling, that's important. If it's in
no, I found in the shloka.
No, I'm not telling you. I'm giving an answer to you. I'm not asking you. In the perspective of differentiating with an enmity that Shiva is the supreme or Krishna is the supreme, you will go to hell because they are non-different. In one term, they are non-different. Why? I will share it with you tomorrow, not today. I will take you through certain things where you will see the clarity with which you will see the position of the Shiva. Why there should be no differentiation? Because Shiva is nothing but a reflection of Krishna. So if you say that the person and the reflection are different, then that is wrong. But one thing you should also understand, that reflection is not the same as the person. There is a simultaneously achinta bheda bheda. Achinta bheda bheda means simultaneously one and different. Simultaneously one, because he is the expansion of the Lord through which the Lord controls the material world. At the same time, he is not the supreme person to say that I own everything. And this is what Lord Shiva tells. He says that, now for example, I will give you another verse where it says, my dear Lord, by the virtue of moment's association with Lord Shiva, who is very dear to you and very intimate to you, we are fortunate to attain you. The Prachetas are telling. See the words of Pracheta. It says that, Vayam tu sakshat bhagwan bhavasya priyasya sakshat krishnasya sangamam, kshana sangamam. Bhavasya means bhava. Bhava means material world. And the master of bhava is Bhavani, that is Shiva. So he says, oh Lord, by the virtue of the moment's association with Lord Shiva, who is very dear to you, and your most intimate friend, we are able to attain you. So when you are friend of Shiva, Shiva will give you, end up with giving you Vishnu only. And when you say no to that, then Shiva starts wondering, are ye mere ko mera devotee bhi bolta aur mera baat bhi nahi mante, what is this here? So we should understand. Then what he says, you are the most expert physician capable of curing any infinite disease. On account of our great fortune, we have been able to take shelter of your lotus feet. So when the Prachetas wanted to attain Lord Narayana, mind you, they were the devotees of Narayana throughout their life, and Lord Brahma came and told them, well, do one thing, go and meet Lord Shiva at Mansarovar and he will guide you how to achieve Lord Narayana. Brahma did not say, okay, go to Narayana and I'm giving you. So they went to Mansarovar and did the tapasya. Lord Shiva came up with the Nandi sitting over there and he embraced them. What he said, because you are the devotee of Krishna, I am so happy to see you, because I normally don't meet anybody who are not devotees of Krishna. Now what have you got to say about this? Why did Lord Shiva utter that word that I am not interested in meeting anybody who is not a devotee of Narayana, but since you are the devotee of Narayana, let me come and embrace you. And then that is how the Rudra Gita starts. The 78 beautiful verses of how he tells, teaches them that how to worship Narayana. And then taking the siksha from Lord Shiva, because he's a Mahajana, because he's a Param Vaishnava, because he's the master of Rudra Sampradaya, the Prachetas, they go and they recite the same verse as taught by Lord Shiva, and they achieve Lord Narayana. And what do they say? Because Lord Shiva is dear to you, and our momentary association with him has given us your association, your darshan. So we should see this from that perspective, because understanding Shiva Tattva is difficult. Because there are, let me tell you one thing. Do you have any knowledge about, I'm just asking the forum, how many tattvas are there basically? Tattva means elements.
Major only Shiva Tattva and Vishnu Tattva. These two are the...
Vishnu Tattva,
Devi Tattva,
Jada Tattva, Shakti Tattva. There are five tattvas. Okay? Shiva Tattva, Vishnu Tattva, Jiva Tattva, Shakti Tattva and Jada Tattva. Jada Tattva means the one which is dead. And Jeev means we. And Shakti means Adi Shakti. And Shiva Tattva and Vishnu Tattva. So who can become Shiva Tattva?
Who can become means?
Shiva Tattva.
Sorry?
Who can become Shiva Tattva?
Who will become the element of Shiva? Is that the question?
Nobody. Nobody, because that is only unique to Lord Shiva. Even Parvati cannot become Shiva Tattva. Even Ganesh cannot become Shiva Tattva. Even Kartikeya cannot become, because Shiva Tattva is unique. Please understand the position of Shiva. He is between Vishnu Tattva and Jiva Tattva. Shiva Tattva is between Vishnu Tattva and Jiva Tattva. So why does Lord Narayana become Shiva?
Yeah, in Tirupati also they are doing a weekly once Rudra Abhishekam with Bilwa leaf to Balaji.
Yeah, so that is the reason I'm asking, what was the need for Lord Narayana to become Lord Shiva?
I don't know. That I don't know, Prabhuji, but one thing is like, you want to tell? Okay. Now my husband is answering.
Yeah, it's okay, no problem. This is just a general discussion, Mataji. Let's try to understand the supremacy of the Lord in the best possible way. Yeah.
Actually, what we know is Shiva is a lot of he's one side is destruction, where yes. Vishnu is protecting. So there has to be balance in ecosystem.
Absolutely, yeah, you are right. Good, yeah. Any other points, Prabhu? Yeah.
He is always there so that to glorify that the God is being known.
So we should understand one thing over here is that, please understand that I will take you back a step now. Have you heard the word Mahapralaya?
Yes, Prabhu.
Have anybody heard the Shabda Mahapralaya?
Yes, Prabhu.
You see the picture that is put by
yes,
Vinay Mukund Prabhu? That is the dance of there. That is the dance of Mahapralaya.
Yeah.
Yeah? So, once the Mahapralaya comes, everything is finished and it goes back into the body of Mahavishnu. We all souls, jivas, who have not attained moksha, and if there is still some desires left to be fulfilled in the material world, so we don't attain moksha and we go back into the body of Mahavishnu. And Mahavishnu is lying on Karana Jal, Karana Ocean, Karana Jala. It is called Karana Shira Sagara. Again, when he desires to create and give an opportunity to the jiva to do their karmas in the right way, so that then they can start doing the karmas and go back to God. So he is in the yoga nidra. He opens his eyes. At that point of time, do you know one form of Shiva is called Sadashiva?
Yes,
one form of Shiva is called
Sadashiv.
What is the tattva of Sadashiv? Is it Shiva tattva or Vishnu tattva?
Shiva tattva.
No, he is Vishnu tattva. That's the point. I'm telling you, understanding Shiva is very difficult. Understanding Vishnu is easy. Understanding Durga is easy. But Shiva Tattva is very, that's the reason people have so many concepts in their mind and they keep conflicting with each other. When he is Sadashiva, he is in Vaikuntha. He is not in the material world because there is no material world. Everything is in the body of Mahavishnu. And there is no Mahavishnu. There is no Mahavishnu, there is no Sadashiva, there is nothing. It's gone.
It's called Brahman, Parabrahma. I'm not talking about Lord Brahma, I'm talking about the, because in Rig Veda, Yajur Veda, Brahman, I'm not talking about the Lord Brahma, I'm again telling. It's like Parabrahma means those, like we are talking about Mahavishnu, Krishna, but there is one more object called Brahman. So I think that will, it will all, we will all get merged with the super consciousness, that is Parabrahma.
Okay. And now, I can tell you, tell me.
And so only I feel like we should not, I pray, I'm not talking about others, whenever we pray, smarthas, as a smartha, we pray, like we don't differentiate between who is supreme. We always feel like we are praying to Parabrahman. Whatever prayer we are doing, it will reach the Parabrahmam, means the super consciousness.
Well, just to reply back on that, in Gita, Krishna rejects that. In Bhagavad Gita, Krishna rejects that. He said, anyway, that is Krishna's wish. If he wants to reject, you can't do anything, I can't do anything. So Krishna rejects that form of worship. He says, whomsoever you pray to, you will go there only. And if you don't pray to a personality, you will go to Brahma Jyoti, which is formless. So that is the verdict of Krishna and Bhagavad Gita. Okay, now let me tell you one thing. The Sadashiva, he stays as a Vishnu Tattva, as a devotee of Vishnu in Vaikuntha, in a place called Ishan. How many of you have heard about Ishan?
Northeast or left?
Northeast. Northeast is Ishaniya. And that Ishaniya is nothing but the house of Sadashiva.
Yeah.
If you go to Sri Ranga, how many of you have been to Sri Rangam temple? Ranganatha Swami. Anybody? Ranganatha Swami. Sri Rangam.
Sri Rangam.
So how many avaranas are there?
Hari Prabhuji.
How many avaranas? Avaranas means how many semicircles are there? If you see the entire Sri Rangam temple from top, there are 7 avaranas. It is like a Vaikuntha. In the center is Lakshmi Narayana.
Correct.
And then there is circle number 1. In the circle number 1, you have the Chaturviva. Vasudeva, Sankarshan, Pratimun, Aniruddha. And in the second avarna, you have the Dasha Avatara of the Lord. In the third avarna, you have the 24 Narayana, Keshavayanama, Narayanama, Madhvayanama, Govindayanama, Vishnuvayanama, Madhusudayanama, Trivikanama, Vamanayanama, Sridharayanama, Rishikeshayanama, Padmanabha, Namudarayanama. Like that, the 24 Narayanas are there. In the fourth avarna, you will have the associates of the Lord. So like that, in the seventh avarna, in the northeast corner, is the house of Sadashiva, which is called Ishaniya. And based on that vastu only we are using on the earth also. So that is the place of Sadashiva. Mahavishnu, I think about the Chaturvyu Narayana. What is the Chaturvyu of Narayana? Vasudev, Sankarshan, Pradyumna, Aniruddha. So this Sankarshana, is nothing but Ananta Shesha. And he is the creator of Sadashiv and Mahavishnu. So the origin of Shiv or Sadashiv starts from Sankarshana, who is in the Chaturvyu of Vaikuntha planetary system. So when the Jivas, they have been given an opportunity to come, Sankarshana produces 2 personalities, Mahavishnu and Sadashiva. That is the reason in Vishnu Sahasranam and in Rudra part, they both are synonymous to each other. The point that you made that who is the Supreme, they all come on the same platform, so it's difficult to understand who is the Supreme. But we need to understand they are created by Sankarshana. So this Sadashiva and Mahavishnu, they both come down. So Sadashiva is just waiting in the Ishaniya area. So if you see, Shivadham is like a globe. It is half Vaikuntha and half material world. The bottom dham is called Mahakaleshwar Dham and the top dham is called Sadashiv Dham. So when he is in Sadashiv, he does not have Parvati over there, nobody over there. He is alone. There is no Ganesh, there is no Parvati, there is nobody. He is Sadashiva. He is a Parabrahma form. There he is sitting and enjoying his meditation on Sankarsana. Now what happens? There he is performing the role of a devotee. There Sadashiva is performing the role of a devotee. Now when Mahavishnu comes and he desires to create the universe so that these jivas can be given a chance to rectify their karma, the same Sadashiva, he comes, he enters the body of Mahavishnu on his will, and then from the eyes of Mahavishnu comes out Shambhu Mahadev or the Mahakaleshwar Dham, Sri Mahakaleshwar. And why he comes out? Because at that point of time, Maya Tatam Idam Sarvam Jagat Avyakta Murtina Matstani Sarva Bhutani Na Chaham Teshav Avasthitaha. Lord Shiva, Lord Krishna tells that everything is created by me, but I don't touch that. For touching that and for creating the issues, or whatever issues means, here I'm telling progeny. Okay? Issue means progeny. Lord Shiva takes the form, and out of Mahavishnu's body comes Rama Devi. Rama is the name of Lakshmi. Okay? And from the body of Rama comes Uma, Parvati or Durga. And Lord Shiva and Durga, now they are associated with each other in front of each other, and Mahavishnu and Lakshmiji are there. So what Lakshmiji does, the complete jivas who come out of the eyes of Mahavishnu is taken by Lakshmiji in her hand, and she hands it over to Lord Shiva. She says, my dear Lord, these jivas I am giving to you. You are the Parameshwara now. You are the Maheshwara now. You take the jiva. And then she gives him a Trishula. Trishula stands for past, present, future. Satogun, Rajogun, Tamogun. Adi Bhautik, Adi Devik, Adhyatmik. So everything related to material is in the hands of Shiva. So Shiva has got a snake in his hand. Shiva has got a Trishul in his hand. And the moment he takes the Trishul, the time starts ticking. 1, 2, 3. Till that time, there was no time. That is how he becomes the master of Kal, known as Mahakaleshwar. And that Shiva, then he goes and impregnates Parvati, and a Shivalinga comes into existence. The female yoni and the male yoni. This is how the existence of Shambhu. So now Shambhu from devotee has become a guna avatara. He has become the avatara where he is going to create this material world. This entire creation of Jagat Janani and Shiva starts taking place. And actually speaking, we know him as a destroyer, but many people, they don't know that he is also one of the creators. He is a master project manager in the creation. What Brahma is doing is a secondary creation. The primary creation after taking from Vishnu is actually done by Shiva and Parvati. That is the reason many people, they claim him to be the supreme, because in this material world, yes, they are the supreme. But beyond this material world, there is a Vaikuntha planetary system where the supremacy does not take place for Lord Shiva. And he just becomes a part of the Vaikuntha on the Ishaniya as Sadashiva. So you need to understand it from this perspective. But not many people understand this. So there is always a conflict and a clash. I can assure you one thing. Within the Shiva Puran also, Lord Shiva, he says that to the northeast part of my dham is the Goloka dham, which is far, far, far above me. And this he is mentioning from his Ishaniya level to the Goloka dham. So here I am not trying to prove who is the supreme. You may continue to do your practices, you may continue to do your worships, but I can assure you one thing, a time will come, the same Lord Shiva is going to enlighten all of us, but who is the supreme. And when he enlightens us, let us not stop that path, but let that knowledge come to us, because he has decided to promote you. It is not Rohit Verma or Vinay Mukund or Suguna Vrinda who is trying to push you. You are here by the mercy of Lord Shiva, because once you say Vaishnavanam Yatha Shambho, and if he is a Vaishnava, he is going to make you a Vaishnava.
Okay, one more question. As you were a Shiva Bhakta before, you must be knowing about Adi Shankara, right?
Yeah.
Adi Shankara, by the name itself, he is incarnation of Lord Shiva himself.
No, don't believe, he is. It is mentioned in Padma Puran. He is okay. The incarnation of Lord Shiva.
Okay. So he has written glories of all types of devis, yes. I mean Mahashakti, like Saundari Lahari, you must be knowing. Saundari,
yes.
Lahari.
Also, he has done many great jobs. Even the Sanskrit that you today has been given his gift. That's his gift.
Yeah. Okay. Yeah. So as Adi Shankara, like in Tamil Nadu, one more he is our Acharya, Advaita Acharya. His name is Mahapariva. He knows all Vedas, like Adi Shankara also know. But they don't. They are whoever devotees, whichever devotees are coming. Like they are only suggesting different pariharams. Those who know all Vedas are not talking about who is supreme, all that. Like Ishta Devata concept they are bringing. Ishta Devata, whichever Ishta Devata we are playing, especially Kula Devata, should not be ignored, etc., etc. So I really don't know. I'm so confused actually. Also, one more question I have in my mind.
Okay. In Srimad Bhagavatam, first, are you going to give me two questions?
No. Is Srimad Bhagavatam just the reference book of other Puranas? Like every time we are only talking about, whenever we open Srimad Bhagavatam, it is this story is from Shiva Purana, this is from Padma Purana, this is from Brahma Vaivarta Purana, Matsya Purana, etc., etc.
Yeah.
It is not having its own story.
It is having. Have you read it? Have you read Bhagavatam?
I was asking you. That's why I'm asking you.
No. Bhagavatam in itself has got the reference of all the others. See, Bhagavatam is called Nigama Kalpataror Dalitam Phalam Shukamukad Amrutam Samyutam Yavata Bhagavatam Vasamale Mura Vikar Bhavuka. Bhagavat is the essence of the entire Vedic philosophy, which includes the 17 Puranas, the four Vedas and 108 Upanishads, because that is what Vyasa rectified his mistake. Now the confusion what you say is absolutely right, Mataji. I am 100% with you. I was also confused. I said, "Yaar, itna sab jhanjat kyun chahiye? Islam says there is one God. Christianity says there is one God, and here we are fighting with each other that who is God."
Okay, now right? if I am an Islam person, and at the time of deathbed, I am thinking Allah. After Allah, I am staying and dying.
Yeah.
Will I get mokta or not? Because I thought about God
so
at the time.
So you will be reaching Shivadham. Says Lord Shiva takes care of it. That's the beauty of Lord Shiva. He is the embodiment of everybody.
Because I used to wonder, with our God,
it's a transit area. Basically, Mataji, it is called as a transit area. Like Dubai is a transit country. So Sadashiv Dham is a transit area. All those people who do not understand Vaikuntha, but have done something good to go out of the material world, they go and stand there for some time, and then they are sent back again by the Shiva's mercy in a proper place, in a proper place. And then they are given proper training so that they understand who is Krishna.
Okay, if going to Vaikuntha is a moksha, or because I am getting confused, I feel like mixed with super consciousness is moksha. Because if Jaya Vijaya is in Vaikuntha only, but he was cursed by Kumbhar and then they came back to planet Earth. So this proves like going to some particular loka is not moksha, because some Kumaras will come and curse me, again I have to come back. Moksha means no better.
Can I ask you one question? The Kumaras just cursed him out of they just felt time pass karna hai, or did they do any mistake?
They must have done mistake, but no, when I claim moksha,
see,
I should not come back, right?
Moksha means you can still come back. There is a free will that Krishna gives you to misuse it even in Vaikuntha, and they misused it. They insulted the devotee of the Lord, and then Narayana had to say, Baba, in this area, there is no ahankara. And if you are having ahankara, then you go to the material world and do your ahankara. So they made a mistake. Why? There are not only Jaya Vijaya, there are 12 Dwarpals of Vaikuntha, not two. Jaya Vijaya, they stand on the western gate. What about the east, north and south? Why they didn't fall down? Because when you are working for King Sheikh Mohammed, and Sheikh Mohammed says that if you have to be gratitude and grateful to the people, you start, you know, acting funny over there and say, "Are, what is it? Why have you come here? No, there is no time. Sheikh is not there." And Sheikh is going to punish you and say, "Baba, on my behalf, why are you taking decision?" Same thing happened to Jaya Vijaya. So Jaya Vijaya fell down from there. Now, the Vaishnava Acharyas, they give another perspective to it. It says, when the Lord wants to reciprocate with his devotees who are chanting his glorious name down, so he creates Sarva Karana Karanam situation. He poisoned the mind of Jaya Vijaya and make them fall down so that he can come down and meet the devotees on the earth and take them back home, back to God. Because that is the reason Krishna says, Paritrana Saduna Vinashaya Cha Dushkritam Dharma Samsthapanartha Sambhavami Yugyoge. His primary job is to come and meet the glorious devotees who are chanting his holy names. Because the devotees want to see Krishna always, so he comes down. Another thing, I am not in a position to take a stand on who the acharyas you are talking about in Tamil Nadu. But from what little bit knowledge that I gained in my 22 years of life, when you say that one who studies Vedas knows everything, what is the goal of studying the Veda? If you could just guide me on that, Mataji. Or anybody in the group could tell me, what is the goal of studying the Veda?
To understand super consciousness and to guide the world accordingly through acharyas.
See, one thing I will tell you, super consciousness is a vague term. It is
no, that is what is mentioned in Rig Veda as Parabrahman.
Krishna has very clearly told that the goal of studying the Veda is to know me in person. In person. Vedeshya Sarvair Aham Eva Vedyo. Aham means me. Me means Krishna in person. So why that term got diluted to the word super consciousness? And when you use the word Parabrahma, so Arjun says, Parabrahma, Param Dhamma, Pavitram, Paramam Bhavam, Purusham, Shashvatam, Divyam, Adidevam, Ajam, Vibhu. Why did Arjun use the terminology Parabrahma to Krishna? Because when he saw the Vishwa Virat Swarup, he realized one thing, that super consciousness, what the Rig Veda is talking about, is you. And that is what exactly Lord Shiva is doing. He is trying to bring you to the Parabrahma concept of the super consciousness. Super consciousness is just an English terminology because English does not have appropriate words. So whatever
word we are using the English term demigod, which I actually hate using that word demigod. So at least I used a better word, super consciousness.
Aparna Mataji,
yeah.
Can you please hold on to your questions? I mean, let's continue with the discussion of Mahajan, and otherwise this is going a different
direction.
So I would it's my humble request to you. That, you know, there are 30 other devotees who are in the forum and who are actually waiting to hear the glories of Lord Shiva. And, you know, what we can do is we can allocate 10 minutes to have a question and answer session. And in case if you have anything which is specific, we can always have one-to-one session. I'm so sorry about this.
Vinayamukam Prabhu, I'll just read a few more things actually.
Yes,
because we need to come back to Lord Shiva again, as I told you that, you know,
yeah.
I can tell you that Shiva is an embodiment of the controller of Tamaguna, the mode of darkness, inertia, and a tendency towards annihilation. This is how we assist in the description of the destruction of the cosmic creation at the end times. What we also need to be understanding is that he is the spiritual master of the entire world. He is a peaceful personality, free from enmity, and always Atmaram. He is the greatest among the demigods and he is the spiritual master of the world by showing the world supreme. The Vallabh Sampradaya and the Vishnu Swami Sampradaya is what he is the master of. I'm just giving the glories of Lord Shiva so you need to understand in what perspective he is the master. Shiva is described as the most powerful, only second to Lord Vishnu. In this way, he is not the supreme but is almost as powerful. Although he has nothing to attain in the material world, he is engaged for the benefit of everyone in this universe. And is accompanied by his material and dangerous energy like Kali and Durga. Shiva is often shown as a handsome young man with a long hair which flows from the spurt of Ganga river, an emblem of purity. Shiva means one who is very pure and auspicious. And he has a great crescent moon on his head. He has a white or a light bluish complexion and sometimes with a third eye in the eyebrows, generally with four arms as a sign of a universal power. When you say he's holding a Trishul, which is the controller of three modes of material nature, the Damru, which is representing the time of the alphabet, language, and the mudras in the hand, Abhayadan and Vardaraj. So he is also giving blessing. And he also known as, sometimes Shiva is also shown as wearing the garlands of skull. So it represents that he is the lord of destruction and the cyclical nature of the appearance and disappearance of the material creation. As I told you that Shiva works for the benefit of everyone, he tries to help the living beings make them spiritual advancement. That is why he is the owner of a disciplic succession. This is also why he says to the sons of King Prachini Bariyava, any person who surrendered to the Supreme Lord Krishna the controller of everything is very dear to me. So this is the first statement that Lord Shiva gave to Prashni Bharyas and Prachitas, that one who is dear to Krishna is dear to me. The sons of the king were going to practice austerities to worship Lord Vishnu, and searching the suitable place happened to find Lord Shiva. So he speaks to the princess as he said, a person who directly surrenders to Krishna or Vishnu in unalloyed devotional service is immediately promoted to the spiritual planet. I, Lord Shiva, and other demigods attain this planet only after the destruction of the material world. Since you are all the devotees of the Lord, I appreciate you, and you are respectable as a supreme personality of Godhead. There is no one as dear to the devotees as I am. Here Shiva is telling his position, that there is no one as dear to devotees to him as I am. So in this way, a devotee of Krishna does not disrespect Lord Shiva, but worships him as the greatest devotee of Lord Krishna. A Krishna Bhakta who prays to Lord Shiva but asks Shiva to assist him in attaining the favor of Lord Krishna is not for merely material benefits. As we find in Tulsi Ramayana Uttarakhand, Lord Rama says, with joined palms, I lay before you another secret doctrine without erroring Shankara or Lord Shiva, a man to attain devotion to me. So in this way, Shiva assists us in attaining the devotion to Lord Krishna in his expansions. After Lord Shiva had spoken to the king of King Prashni Bharya, he relates a particular mantra for the benefit of the pure auspicious for anyone to attain him. This mantra is called Shiva's song or the Rudra Gitam, which consists of verses from shloka number 33 to 79 in chapter number 24 of 4th canto of Srimad Bhagavatam. When you actually listen to the Rudra Gitam, you will realize that how much Lord Shiva wants every soul to go back home, back to Godhead, to Krishna. And if this is the gift that he wants to give us as a Mahajana, it is not only our duty, but you should say it is our great fortune that we are in a situation where Lord Shiva is slowly pushing us to the different levels of Vaikuntha planetary system. O Supreme Personality of Godhead, all glories unto you. You are the most exalted of all self-realized souls. Since you are always auspicious for self-realized, I wish that you be auspicious to me also. This is Lord Shiva telling. You are worshipable by the virtue of all perfect instructions you give. You are the super soul. Therefore, by offering my respectful obeisances unto you. In the Bhagavatam 4.3.23, Lord Shiva's position is said. Lord Shiva himself tells his wife Sati, he is always engaged in worshipping the Supreme Personality known as Lord Vasudeva Krishna, who is revealed in pure consciousness. The super consciousness that you are telling Mataji is this pure consciousness, which Lord Shiva is also talking about. Super consciousness means it is Krishna or Vishnu. Herein we can see that in actually Lord Shiva is subordinate to Lord Vishnu. Krishna in that he is also set apart of Lord Krishna's universal form, as described in Bhagavad Gita. Therein we find Arjuna said, my dear Lord Krishna, I can see assembled in your universal form all the demigods. I see Brahma sitting on a lotus, as well as Shiva and many other sages and divine serpents. So what I would do, it's already 9:29. So what I would do is we will all...
Prabhu, what we can do is we can pause here and we can continue the session tomorrow. And maybe we can have extra 15-20 minutes tomorrow. I'm sure Aparna Mataji will have so many questions to ask.
And but I want to know one thing. Other than Aparna Mataji, why nobody else is asking anything?
No, Prabhuji, the thing is, Aparna has read so many things and she has got in blessings from her appa, lot of literatures. So she was been reading. Wo 108 times usko main bolti hu mahamantra jap karo, lekin wo appa ka hi naam japti hai baar baar. So,
Lord Shiva will convince her. I'm sure Lord Shiva will convince her, because that is the reason she has joined her association.
For me, both are equal. I don't have problems whoever is supreme. What I want is moksha. Even if Muruga is giving moksha, I'm ready to take it. that is my point of view.
Mataji, that correction has to happen. You know why? That is the reason Shiva has put you in this trouble. Because Shiva disagrees that both are equal. And you are pushing that both are equal. So what to do now? You are putting him in Dharma Sankata. He knows his position, but we out of our love and affection, we change the position, we say that he is the supreme. Actually, it is not.
But finally, at the deathbed, which mantra I am going to tell, So that only God knows. So they will let them decide.
Prabhu, Lord has many times given her messages, but what happens is she is not getting the correct message. Many a times.
No, she coming and joining the Association of Vaishnavas is an indication that what Lord Shiva wants to do her. And I'm sure Shiva will definitely take care of it, because like he took care of me. I used to do Rudram Chamakam Namakam Rudra part every day. We used to worship the Lord Shiva Shivalinga in the Shiva temple every day. And I used to put Basma, and I used to never enter Krishna temple in my life. Never ever. I had no business.
No, no. But I enter all the temples.
She's chanting 16 rounds.
As the time went by, Lord Shiva was very delicately trying to tell me, my child, enough of your bhakti. Now let me put you to the real bhakti. And today when I see myself, I'm really shocked. So I don't miss out on a single Shiva Kshetra, because Chaitanya Mahaprabhu did it, so we are doing. We are his followers. And as I told you, that Lord Shiva is a very unique personality. There is no personality to match him. That is the reason he's so difficult to understand, because he plays multiple roles. And the problem is, when someone plays multiple roles, then you get confused. Array, somewhere he's shown that he's superior. Somewhere Lord Ramachandra is praying to him. We have seen that also. Somewhere he's taking halal. So people say, why Vishnu could not do, Shiva could it, so Shiva is supreme. So like that, you will find so many things. But in the end, tomorrow I will give you a mantra by Lord Shiva, and which is not from any Vaishnava book. Which is not from any Vaishnava booklet. So that you cannot tell me, Prabhu, you are quoting Vaishnavism. I will quote you Shivism. And look what he tells Kartike. And with that, if you could understand, if you really feel that Shiva is your Aradhya, then you should understand what your Aradhya is trying to tell you. And in that mantra, he will make a point, and if that point could be understood by us, our life will become successful. Because when we consider someone to be as our teacher, when we consider someone to be our Aradhya, and when the Aradhya himself comes and says, my dear child, this is how you should understand this Shastra, then you have to start understanding from that place. Because otherwise, when you don't do that, like you have a children and you tell your child, my dear child, this is what you need to do. But the child fails to understand because he has his set notions and he wants to get through those things only. Then what happens? Then sometimes you say, okay, the time they go, Sikh jayega baad mein. As the time goes by, he will understand. And as the time goes by, when the child understands, he says, oh, Kanna, you're such a nice person, such a wonderful child, Kanna, you understood it. This is what I want. So I will reveal that answer tomorrow to you, and I will take you through a small virtual tour, which is the culmination of all the Shastras, and see for yourself where is Shiva, where is Krishna, where is Brahma, and where are these personalities, Mahesh Dham, Devi Dham, and what they are doing over there, and what are they expected to do. So that clarity will be there. Because remember one thing, when Adi Shankaracharya's case you were telling, so if you read the Padma Puran, in Padma Puran, Lord Shiva and Parvati, they are having a conversation. Lord Shiva tells Parvati, under the instructions of Lord Narayana, I am going to take birth of a Brahmana child in the southern part of India and preach Advaitavadi philosophy so that we have to resurrect the Vedic samskara system. You need to understand why Shankara did not elaborately opened everything. Though in his Achyuta Astakam, Sudarshana Astakam and Bhaj Govindam, he very clearly says, Govindam Bhaja Mudamate, Samprapte San Nahite Kale Nahi Nahi Rakshati Karna. Why did he use that word? Because he realized one thing, that all the expertise of your grammatical pronunciations at the time of death will not help you. Because Ida Sansare, Bahu Dukkhare, Kripaya Pahe, Pahe, he did not use the word Shankara, he used the word Murare. So you have to check with Adi Shankara that why did he speak like that. So there are so many things that we can always discuss and debate. But at the end of the day, we have to understand that what is it that the Lord is trying to tell us? What is it that this Mahajana wants us to know? What is it that is there in his mind that he has brought us to this discussion today?
Absolutely.
Yes.
Yes, Prabhu. Even I had a lot of questions. Maybe as Prabhuji mentioned, maybe we can have one-on-one session, because I think it's too elaborate. I mean, there are a lot of questions which I have. So, but then I think maybe I'll reserve it, and maybe we can arrange for some kind of a only question-answer discussion, keeping this topic as a key agenda point, and maybe we can discuss on that.
Thank you, Amitji.
Thank you.
Thank you, Prabhuji.
Thank you so much, Prabhuji.